All this week, I've been exhorting you to wake up to the truth about what's going on in this country. It's happening right in front of us. It's troubling, and it demands a response from all of us who recognize the need to restore self-government. But as much as what's going on should trouble you, there's also a bright light shining in this country from your fellow citizens who are taking on the heights of corrupt power in new ways and exposing their weakness. And in doing so, they're providing us a real-time lesson on where power lies in America today. Today, we can find hope in the lowest levels of infection since March of last year, a result we can all be thankful for. It's a result achieved not through draconian government policies of lockdown and mandates, but thanks to sweeping regulations out of the way. How out of touch are your would-be commandants? They're still trying to run with the permanent pandemic. Look to Michigan Governor Gretchen Whitmer, once the darling of swamp publications like Politico, before she prohibited people from buying seeds, now reduced to vetoing attempts to lift graduation limits and bills allowing public records requests because COVID. Or Gavin Newsom, clinging to power like a broken despot, refusing to lift a state of emergency in California, even as the rest of the country is returning to normal. Contrast that with Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, who told Laura Ingraham last night, "In Florida, we chose freedom over Fauciism." Human actions and decisions made the real-life costs of the pandemic far higher than they otherwise might have been. They unnecessarily erased an entire year of education, destroyed small businesses, and wrecked huge portions of our economy. Instead, it was America's innovation industry that won the day, in ways the corporate propaganda press last year deemed impossible, all the way up until the vaccines were here. The ruling class used the threat of disease to consolidate its power, and it has used lies, violent riots, re-education, corporate media propaganda, and tech censorship to achieve this. But it is a house that cannot stand, because it is built on nothing but threats and the kind of shameless hubris we've had to see to believe. The Wuhan lab leak theory, dismissed by Anthony Fauci and the Washington Post and CNN, is gaining traction now, and it's cause for outrage at elite hypocrisy and dishonesty. But it also exposes this temple and is another example of what author Michael Malice calls the cathedral of power, which can be beaten if only Americans will find the will to take it on. So what is holding us back? And where should we be going? The truth is that we are needlessly distracted by federal politics, by Nancy Pelosi and Mitch McConnell, when we should be paying attention to the actual centers of power. You won't find them in our feckless octogenarian government. No, the real threat to American liberty is in the halls of Harvard, the boardrooms of Google, and the cubicles of the New York Times. Our unelected rulers are more dangerous to our freedoms than the elected. We see it again today. Facebook doing what the government cannot, unilaterally shutting down the voice of a former president of the United States. They even used a former official of a foreign government to deliver the news. The cathedral is all the people telling you what's happening now is normal, totally normal, so normal. Without Donald Trump in office, we're back to a normal politician like Joe Biden. And what has he done with that mandate for normalcy? A border crisis, pipeline destruction, job losses, wage declines, gas shortages, exploding inflation, taxpayer funding of abortion, war in the Middle East, trans craziness, weaponizing political power to crush conservatives in the military, and deficits that are going from horrific under the GOP to actually threatening the Republic. Isn't normalcy grand? And why does it seem so brittle? Yes, America is in crisis, but more and more Americans are waking up to the truth. Think of government today as the great and powerful Oz. It seems in the moment like its power is overwhelming and eternal, that it can grant every wish or destroy what it will. But as we saw this week in places like Loudoun County, where a brave teacher had the audacity to say no, just a little American spirit, a man who will stand up, can challenge these powers in ways that reveal the weakness of their control of the narrative. Bold patriots have the capacity to pull the curtain back and reveal our federal government to be just a bunch of elderly men frantically pulling levers, hoping if they say amen and amen, they can white-knuckle it to the end. The cult religion of American wokeness is a feature of this. Every survey will indicate to you that strains like critical race theory represent the ideology of the rich white people who occupy the cathedral. Black and Hispanic Americans like tradition. They like marriage and manliness. They respect police and the military. They make up a sizable portion of them. and they have little time for the theories of the so-called anti-racists. There is an odd demographic desperation in wokeism. The cathedral tells us we are supposed to be celebrating the imminent replacement of white people as the majority of the United States. But now we punish people for not thinking like them. It's as if the aging, wealthy white population in America sees the privilege they will soon be losing, and they're trying to deposit as many gains in the cultural bank account as they can before the jig is up. Part of waking up is paying more attention to the things that are closer to you. In December 1946, in a letter to a friend, C.S. Lewis wrote, "It is one of the evils of rapid diffusion of news that the sorrows of all the world come to us every morning. I think each village was meant to feel pity for its own sick and poor, whom it can help. And I doubt if it is the duty of any private person to fix his mind on ills which he cannot help. This may even become an escape from the works of charity we really can do to those we know. A great many people, not you, do now seem to think that the mere state of being worried is in itself meritorious. I don't think it is. We must, if it so happens, give our lives for others. But even while we're doing it, I think we're meant to enjoy our Lord and in Him, our friends, our food, our sleep, our jokes, and the bird song and the frosty sunrise. As about the distant, so about the future. It is very dark, but there's usually light enough for the next step or so." That message should give all of you hope. The lessons we take away from this year of domineering pandemic governance is that it is even more feeble than we thought. Taking it on in small ways and big, confronting its hypocrisy and lies in our communities, and returning its power back to where it belongs, the people, is our mission now. And how do you know if you're part of this great mission? There's a simple way to know. You don't need a sign out in front in rainbow colors that says this house believes in science and refugees and all the rest. All you have to do is stand up, open your front door, and look out. If there is a red, white, and blue flag waving there, it means you owe it your allegiance, and it owes you protection of your God-given rights. It means you are a citizen, not a subject. And in this day and age, it means you're in the fray. I'm Ben Domenech. This is the American Crisis.